Hey, I'm Joe, and I'm a researcher studying for a PhD in zoology at Oxford Uni. And this is a presentation about evolutionary conflict, where I'll focus in a lot on sexual conflict. So the objectives of this presentation are to understand why individuals of the same species can have different evolutionary interests, how this leads to different types of conflict between males and females, and the consequences of this sexual conflict on individual and population levels. So what is evolutionary conflict? Well, evolutionary conflict occurs when two parties gain from different versions of the same phenotype that they can both affect through evolution. This may sound confusing, but actually you will have come across this concept when learning about natural selection. Take this interaction between a lion predator and its zebra prey. Natural selection theory teaches us that lions have evolved features to increase their ability to prey on zebras, such as acute sense of smell, night vision, and the ability to put on high bursts of speed. In contrast, zebras have evolved adaptations to help them avoid predators, such as stamina and their stripes. Now, this actually covers the theory of evolutionary conflict. So there are two different versions of something, a single phenotype, that these two species are sharing an evolutionary interest in this predator-prey interaction. So try and pause the video and have a think about exactly what this single thing is. So, it may seem silly, but of course the two species are both interested in different versions of the zebra itself, or more specifically, the zebra's flesh. So, going back to how this fits with our definition of evolutionary conflict, the two parties are the lion and the zebra, the phenotype they share an interest in is the zebra's flesh, and the two versions are dead and as food for the lion, or alive and functioning for the zebra. So instead of thinking of these two species as evolving as single units, you can shift your focus to how they're evolving as a means to produce different versions of the zebra's flesh. Now, hopefully what you've learnt before about natural selection has taught you how populations of animals respond to different selection pressures, leading to the creation of new species as populations evolve to be more dissimilar to each other. Well, coming back to evolutionary conflict, surely the fact that members of a single species have all evolved together means that they have the same evolutionary interests, so there isn't any conflict, right? I mean, no lions would prefer to preserve zebras and go hungry, so they all share the same interest. Well, while this is true about lions, it isn't the case that evolutionary conflict can't exist within species. Conflict between members of the same species is called intraspecific evolutionary conflict, intra meaning within specific species, so within species. So let's think of an example where individuals within a species may want evolution to act differently on a shared feature. So here are two peacocks. Now pause the video and have a think of what strikes you about these peacocks and how different peacocks may want evolution to create different versions of shared features. So you might have thought of different ideas. But something obvious about these peacocks is that they look completely different. And this is because males want to evolve bright feathers to make them more attractive mates, something I'll come back to later, while females want duller feathers for camouflage. So there's clear conflict here, whether males and females want evolution to act differently on their feathers. This type of intraspecific evolutionary conflict between males and females is called sexual conflict, and it's what I'll focus on for the rest of the presentation. Sexual conflict occurs when the evolutionary interests of males and females differ, and it's particularly widespread because of differences in the fundamental biology of the two sexes. So as you will have been taught, male and female animals differ in their sex gametes, which is called anisogamy. Females produce large and mostly immobile gametes called eggs, while males produce much smaller and mobile gametes called sperm. Because of the size difference, males can produce many, many more sperm cells than females can eggs, which causes a difference in the ability of the two sexes to reproduce, where males can theoretically reproduce much more but are limited by the availability of eggs, while females are limited by their own ability to produce eggs and so can reproduce less. These limitations lead to something called sexual selection, where males evolve to have competitive advantages over other males in terms of access to females, which is called the law of battle, while females evolve to prefer males that are more likely to produce higher quality offspring, called female choice, which in turn leads to male adaptations that indicate their quality as a mate. So, revisiting our peacocks and our original definition of evolutionary conflict, the two parties are male and female peacocks, the phenotype is feathers, and the different versions they want is males want bright feathers to indicate their quality and attract mates, while females want duller feathers as they don't need to attract mates, and so would prefer to camouflage themselves against predators. And so there's sexual conflict. Now, sexual conflict exists in two forms, intralocus and interlocus, which differ at the genetic level but have big differences for individuals and populations. Intralocus sexual conflict arises between male and females when different alleles at the same locus are preferred in one sex but not the other. So, say there's this chromosome found in peacocks, and on this chromosome there's a locus, or just an area, that has the gene that controls what colour feathers become. Now, say this chromosome is found in both males and females. However, males want a version of the gene that makes colourful feathers, whereas females want a version that makes them duller. Well, this causes conflict, because if the expression of the gene moves males towards their optimum phenotypic value, in this case, colourful feathers, it's moving it in the opposite direction for females. So this trait is under what's called sexually antagonistic selection, where a sort of evolutionary tug of war means that neither sex reaches its adaptive peak, as the gene may evolve to be the average of the colourful and dull version. So how is this conflict resolved? Well, we know that it's not the case that the average phenotype always evolves, because there's tons of evidence that males and females look very different to each other, such as peacocks, which is called sexual dimorphism. So I want you to pause the video and have a think about how it might be possible that males and females can have different phenotypes of shared genes despite having the same genome. Okay, so there are a few ideas that might explain how this conflict is resolved. One of these is that the gene or genes that control the shared phenotype may have undergone duplication on the chromosome, and then one of these versions, which are called paralogs, can be expressed either in males or females. And this is possible because other genes in the genome regulate which of the two paralogs is switched on, an idea that you might have come across called epigenetics, which means sex-specific gene expression is possible. A second way that the conflict might be resolved is through a process called alternative splicing. And this allows males and females to have the same gene on their chromosome, which, going back to basics, means they have the same sequence of nucleotides. However, when the gene is transcribed into mRNA, it's cut up in different ways depending on whether it's in a male or a female, changing the sequence of nucleotides and allowing the two sexes to derive different products. And a final way that the conflict might be resolved is if the gene becomes linked to a sex-determining chromosome. So, if you remember, in humans, males and females share the same number and type of chromosomes, apart from one, where females have two X chromosomes, whereas males have just one of these, as well as a chromosome not in females, called a Y chromosome. And this is the case in all mammals, whereas birds have a very similar system, but instead, males have two Z chromosomes, while females have one Z chromosome and one W chromosome. So you can imagine a situation where, for example, a gene might exist on the female-only W chromosome allowing for dull feather coloration that overrides any gene on the Z chromosome, and this gene will be selected for female benefit without any repercussions for males. So we've talked about how males and females may want different versions of the same gene, but what about when males and females want different versions of the same phenotype, but they change this phenotype through genes that are completely different to one another and are at different loci? This is interlocus sexual conflict, which arises when alleles at different loci in males and females are selected for in the evolutionary interest of the sex that bears these alleles, but at the cost to the other sex. And this is generally associated with phenotypes directly involved in reproductive interactions. So, to explain this, in all instances of reproduction, there are costs and benefits to both sexes. The benefit is passing on genes to future generations with which both males and females achieve equally. But the costs are often not shared as symmetrically. So males generally lose little during reproduction, as their gametes are disposable because they create so many, and they generally don't provide care for the fertilised embryo and future offspring as much as females do. For example, think of pregnancy in mammals, where it's almost always the female that invests much more into future offspring. So, although, as is always the case in biology, there are exceptions to the rule, it can be thought that males want to reproduce as much as possible as the cost is lower to them, whereas the cost of reproduction for females is higher, and so they don't want to mate at this same rate. And it's this aspect that causes interlocus sexual conflict, as males and females want different outcomes when it comes to the rate of producing offspring. So what are the consequences? Well, at this point, it's probably easier to understand by putting it into context with an example of a shared phenotype that both males and females try to change. So let's take the example of mating rate. So mating rate is a shared phenotype, but we're no longer talking about a single gene that controls this, as was the case in intralocus conflict, but we're now talking about genes that are found at different loci and maybe even on completely different chromosomes. Now, something like mating rate is very complex and will be regulated by lots of genes, but for simplicity, let's suppose it's controlled by genes found in just one locus in males, let's call this locus M, and by genes in a completely different locus and chromosome in females, so let's call this locus F. Well, the optimal outcome of mating is different for the two sexes, as I explained, so genes at locus M that increase mating rate will be favoured by males, and so spread through the population over generations. And while this is adaptive for males, it's maladaptive for females. So the presence of these genes at locus M exerts selective pressure at locus F for genes that decrease mating rate. And these will be favoured by females and so spread through generations, exerting selective pressure back on locus M. And this will continue over and over as the genes are spread down generations, leading to a process called sexually antagonistic coevolution. This coevolution leads to what's known as arms race dynamics, where the existence of a sexually antagonistic adaptation reinforces the evolutionary escalation of the other, which gets more and more exaggerated over generations. So one very gruesome example of this is a process that's evolved in lots of invertebrates called traumatic insemination. And this is a form of mating where these arms race dynamics have led to the modification of male genitalia to produce a hypodermic penis. And this is essentially used like a needle by insects and pierces the female's body walls during copulation, and then the male deposits the sperm directly into the haemocyl, which is kind of like the insect's blood. And as I said, this is very gruesome, but it isn't without a sexually antagonistic female adaptation that co-evolves in response. So amazingly, many female invertebrates have the ability to destroy this haemophilic sperm by producing enzymes to digest them, which is pretty cool. So as we did with intralocus conflict, let's ask whether this type of conflict can be resolved. Well, what exactly do we mean by conflict resolution? When we were talking about intralocus conflict, the conflict was that, on an evolutionary scale, males and females want different versions of phenotypes. Male peacocks want bright feathers, females want dull feathers. This was resolved through sex-limited expression, and so both preferred phenotypes could coexist. However, in interlocus conflict, males and females want different versions of phenotypes that are part of shared reproductive interactions. Males want female mating rate to be higher, females want female mating rate to be lower. So there's no longer a case for resolution, because these two versions can't coexist. So thinking about this laterally in comparison to peacock's feathers, so long as sex-limited expression is feasible, at any one point in time, the existence of both feather types is possible. However, it's not possible that during a reproductive interaction between, say, these two damselflies, there's both a very high and a low female mating rate simultaneously. And so the two optimum outcomes for the sexes can't coexist. So what does this mean? Well, it means that you'll often see these arms race dynamics to continue instead of resolution. But this is a really current and active area of research, and we don't fully know what interlocus conflict leads to. So some research indicates that the ongoing arms race can lead to extinction, because the direct cost that antagonistic adaptations have on one of the sexes leads to reduced reproductive capability of the entire population. But other research suggests that it may lead to new species forming. So, for example, when a species becomes geographically separated into two populations, the two populations will both co-evolve sexually antagonistic traits within their own populations, but between the two, the adaptations may differ, causing them to diverge in morphology and behaviour to create new species. So I've gone through a lot of content here, and hopefully you don't feel too overwhelmed by it. But the main thing that I'm hoping is that you just have more of an appreciation that evolution isn't always as simple as the classic survival of the fittest model, where animals change step by step in response to their environment. But on top of this, different complex evolutionary dynamics can be introduced through other means, such as conflict between the two sexes. So to sum up what I've gone through, evolutionary conflict occurs when two parties want different evolutionary outcomes over a shared phenotype or interaction. Males and females fundamentally have different interests when it comes to reproduction, ultimately due to the differences between their gametes, and this conflict can lead to sex-specific adaptations that benefit the sex that bears them, but disadvantages the opposite sex. And this is an important process in the evolution of behaviour, physiology, and morphology within the animal kingdom, and sexual conflict resolution, or lack thereof, has the potential to affect whole population-level processes. So I'll leave you with this final slide, which has some extra resources, as well as asking whether evolutionary sexual conflict is overall good or bad for the animal kingdom and its diversity. And this is definitely up for debate, and at this point there's a lot of work to be done to answer it. So it's a question I'll leave you with to think about yourself. Thanks very much for listening.